Tribe in B News. In legal news, the Los Angeles earthquake has pushed back a court date for Beastie Boy Adam Horovitz, whose arraignment on grand theft and battery charges will now take place on February 3rd. Ad-Rock is arrested for allegedly assaulting a cameraman for the tabloid TV show Hard Copy and appropriating his videotape at a November memorial service for the late actor River Phoenix. The maximum sentence, if Horovitz were to be convicted, is a year in jail and a $1,000 fine. Far more entertaining Beastie Boys news, the trio has now come out with its own magazine, and it turns out to be one of the funniest reads around. Grand Royal is, as its proprietors acknowledge, a celebration of inside humor, basketball trivia, slang, blatant opinions, and half-baked notions. Among its features are Pal Joey, a fashion primer for those in pursuit of that elusive Buttafuoco look, Adam Yauch's account of his snowboarding adventures in Alaska, Mike D's poolside interview with the Far Side, artwork by colorblind P-Funk leader George Clinton, and a page full of scabrous rants called The Captain's Beefs, in which the otherwise unidentified captain at one point says of a particularly attractive member of the group TLC, quote, "Girlfriend, would I like to get your tray table in an upright and locked position?" Also, Mike Watt on flannel, an interview with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar on his late martial arts teacher Bruce Lee, and a telephone interview with rap mogul Russell Simmons that was conducted without telling Simmons he was being taped, and they printed it anyway. Grand Royal is available at record stores, skate shops, and futuristic newsstands near you, and is definitely worth checking out.
Beastie Boys' journey started in New York City in the early 1980s when they were part of the punk rock band called the Young Aborigines. Soon, they found inspiration in their skateboarding crew and shifted their focus to hip-hop, eventually becoming the Beastie Boys. Comprised of Adam Ad-Rock Horovitz, Michael Mike D. Diamond, and Adam MCA Yao, the group set the stage for their genre-blending debut. Their debut album in 1986, Licensed Ill, combined rap, rock, and punk, which led them to the mainstream success and helped popularize hip-hop and pop music. As they progressed, the Beastie Boys explored different musical styles and established themselves as influential figures in the alternative music scene. The Beastie Boys continued to redefine their sound with their 1989 release, Paul's Boutique. This experimental album featured an eclectic mix of musical influences and reinforced their status as pioneers in the alternative music world. In 1992, they released Check Your Head, which marked a return to their punk roots. The group played their instruments on most of the album's tracks, emphasizing their dedication to exploring diverse musical styles and pushing the boundaries of hip-hop. In February 1992, the Beastie Boys made a bold move, leaving Def Jam Recordings to partner with Capitol Records and establish their own label, Grand Royal Records. Operating out of Los Angeles, this innovative label was dedicated to promoting an eclectic range of musical talent from alternative rock to electronic music. Grand Royal Records, initially intended as a vanity label, showcased the Beastie Boys' diverse musical interests and their steadfast commitment to fostering creativity.
At first, Grand Royal was just a logo and a vague notion. When we signed with Capitol, the only other labels we'd been on were Rat Cage and Def Jam. Both of them had an us-against-the-world, anti-establishment outlook, even after Def Jam partnered with CBS, and we fed off of that. Capitol Records, on the other hand, was the establishment. We were never 100% comfortable with that, so as part of our deal, we negotiated the right to put our records out on our own label within Capitol. No, we didn't have a label or intend to start one. Instead, we spent a bunch of time coming up with a name and logo for our non-existent label and slapped both on Check Your Head. Look, we got a label. The logo proves it. The name Grand Royal and accompanying catchphrase, "Guaranteed Every Time," were copped from Biz Markie, who said both into the mic, probably after consuming half a bag of candy. Sometime right after Check Your Head came out, we got a cassette of demos from a couple of old friends, Jill Kniff and Gabby Glazer, two of the original Bag Ladies. Their band was called Luscious Jackson. Jill asked if we could help with getting the demo to people to see if a label might be interested in putting it out. At that point, the three of us were becoming slightly less self-involved, meaning that instead of ignoring such requests, we actually wanted to help our friends if we could. So we listened. I was trying to think of what record labels to send it to when Yauk just said, "Hey, we should put that out ourselves." Of course, this was Yauk's idea. He was definitely the most generous of the three of us, and he was always undeterred by thinking big. At the same time, he and we didn't think of it as just helping friends. He genuinely loved the music and thought it deserved to be heard. I told Jill our idea, and she accepted. Just like that, Grand Royal was an actual record label. Immediately, we were confronted with the next inescapable fact. We had zero infrastructure, and even less of an idea of what we were doing. We had to figure out how to manufacture, distribute, and promote a record. We'd seen hardcore bands do it. How hard could it be? Answer: really fucking hard. Pretty quickly, we managed to figure out the easy part, getting the LP, CD, cassette manufactured. It was an 8-song EP, In Search of Manny. The finished version was even better than the demo, and as a cosmic bonus for us, our old drummer, Kate Schellenbach, whom we'd rather shittily kicked out of the band 8 years before, had joined Luscious Jackson. It wouldn't make up for how we had treated her, but maybe we could start repairing a friendship at least. The EP came out, and people liked it, which alone was gratifying. We had no fucking idea that all these little record stores all over the world had to be called and told that a new record was out and which distributor they could get it from. Even worse, we had no idea how to get paid by independent record distributors, nor did we understand for most of them their business model was only to pay the people they absolutely had to pay.
During the 1990s, a computer science student and avid Beastie Boys fan, Ian Rogers, took it upon himself to develop a website that would celebrate the group's music and legacy.
I never listened to License to Ill in the 80s, but Paul's Boutique hit the bullseye for me. I became obsessed with that record in a way we don't get obsessed with albums in the streaming internet music age. Memorizing every moment, identifying and making mixtapes from the samples, noting and looking for hidden meaning behind each lyrical reference.
Rogers' groundbreaking website quickly became a one-stop destination for dedicated Beastie Boys fans.
When I went to college in Bloomington in 1991, I bought a used IBM 8088 XT clone with an amber monochrome monitor and quickly discovered Usenet. International internet message boards where nerds from around the world wrote endlessly about whatever they were into. I'm sure Usenet had professional uses, but I used it for the same reasons I use Instagram today: music and skateboarding. I contributed to Usenet in the two ways I was most qualified: transcribing and posting David Bowie lyrics, and maintaining the Beastie Boys' Frequently Asked Questions, or FAQ. For the Beastie Boys' FAQ, I dutifully determined what the important questions were, made sure they were answered, and posted the organized document to a Usenet news group called alt.fan.beastie-boys once a week. Still, I was obsessed with putting everything I could find on my Beastie Boys website. The Beastie Boys catalog was fun to obsess over. I started scanning and posting every magazine article I could find, because linking to the article in your favorite magazine was still several years away. So the website not only answered your newbie questions, is Screech from Saved by the Bell, Mike D's brother, it also tipped you off to all the stuff you didn't even know existed. While I'm sure the audience was infinitely small by today's standards, the Beastie Boys website was one of the few must-see sites for people just coming online, and that distinction made me all the more determined to make it definitive. I was no lawyer, but I was pretty sure the scanning of magazine articles and appropriating of logos and images wasn't legal without permission. So when I got a call from a woman named Beth Ann who worked with Beastie Boys, I was stunned and pretty sure the next step was a cease and desist. But when I talked to Beastie Boys manager John Silva, he said, "Sue you? No, I want you to do this for all my bands." Not only did he not shut me down, he offered to pay me for the time I spent on the Beastie Boys site. I was making $6.50 an hour working at the IU Music School Library at the time, so I went in for the kill. I asked for $8.50 an hour to build websites.
In his new role, Rogers introduced the Beastie Boys to the online world, giving them an extensive tour of the website and showcasing the power of the internet.
This was my first time ever having special access to anything. Yauk volunteered to show me around. We played basketball and rode skateboards. I played one-on-one basketball with Billy Corgan. I have a vague memory of George Clinton feeding me spaghetti off of his plate. The entire day was thrilling. Despite my lackluster presentation, Mike and Yauch got the potential of the technology immediately. They saw the value of a direct path to Beastie Boys fans without MTV or radio in the middle. On the spot, we decided to put their magazine, Grand Royal, online and take the out-of-print first issue and make it available in its entirety for free on the web. It was like a fanzine, but on a computer. A few weeks later, someone named JC from the management company called. "We're gonna need you in LA for pre-production in March, and we need a budget." I told him I thought there was some mistake. Mike just asked me for an idea, and I gave him one. "Y'all should totally do it," I said. "I mean, I don't even know how to do it. I'm still in college." JC calmly said, "You wanna do this, kid? We'll figure it out." We built video game machines out of classic junked Space Invaders and Lunar Lander machines I found in Indianapolis and had trucked to Los Angeles. We begged Apple to give us hardware. We put joysticks on the front and used QuickTime VR Studio as an interface to launch loud videos from Beastie Boys, DJ Hurricane, and other Grand Royal artists. We put loudspeakers and big monitors on top of the video games to make them a spectacle on the concourse level of the venue. They were cool in 1995, and even if they existed today, you'd have to nod your head and give it up. Shit was dope. Nerdy, but dope. In those days, you couldn't say, "Check out my website," because maybe one out of every 100 people had ever heard of one. So on the 1995 tour, we launched our own grassroots campaign to get people to try the internet. We handed out floppy disks at the shows.
"Kids, do not hand out floppy disks at your show. Morons will throw them at you."
If you put them in your computer, they signed you up to an internet account, white label ISP through Spry, and dropped you right on the Beastie Boys webpage. Finally, on that 1995 tour, we pioneered the idea of posting live from the show. No mobile internet, so I was taking photos with an early Apple QuickTake camera, running backstage and uploading grainy photos over a phone line, while my best friend from college, Mark Thompson, wrote sarcastic stories about every show and every city we traveled through. That's the story of how Beastie Boys became internet pioneers, and I started a career in digital music.
Grand Royal Records rapidly gained a reputation for supporting unique and unconventional artists. Notable artists who found success on the label included Sean Lennon, who released his debut album Into the Sun in 1998, Atari Teenage Riot, a German digital hardcore band, and the Japanese alternative hip-hop group Buffalo Daughter. In addition to promoting artists, Grand Royal Records released a series of compilation albums, such as At Home with the Groove Box 2000, featuring various artists using the Roland MC-505 Groove Box. These compilations offered a platform for emerging artists, further solidifying the band's reputation as a creative talent hub. This nurturing of creativity would draw in individuals like Ricky Powell, who became known as the fourth Beastie Boy. Ricky Powell's journey with the Beastie Boys began when he joined their 1986 License to Ill tour as their photographer. His work with the band helped to visually document their rise to fame and energy that defined their music and live performances. Powell's photography was not limited to the Beastie Boys. He also captured the essence of the broader New York City art, music, and fashion scenes during the 80s and 90s, shooting for publications like The Village Voice, The New York Times, and Interview Magazine. Throughout the years, Ricky Powell's photography has been showcased in galleries across the globe, with multiple books featuring his work, such as The Individualist. In public access, Ricky Powell photographs 1985 through 2005. His unique style of capturing raw, unfiltered moments in the lives of his subjects has earned him recognition and acclaim within the realms of hip-hop, art, and photography. Building on the success of Grand Royal Records, the Beastie Boys embarked on another creative endeavor, Grand Royal Magazine. Launched in 1993, the magazine showcased the group's diverse interests, passions spanning music, fashion, art, and pop culture. Jeff Tremaine, who has later gained fame as the director of the Jackass TV show, edited the first issue, reinforcing the publication's connection to cutting-edge culture. The magazine rapidly attracted a cult following, thanks to its eclectic content and irreverent style. Grand Royal Magazine not only became a cultural phenomenon, but also played a crucial role in solidifying the Beastie Boys brand.
Pre-internet, there were only a handful of ways that people could experience new music: hearing it on the radio, in a record store, or at a club. or reading about it in the press. Each of these avenues of exposure had its own subculture and its own gatekeepers. Since we are already mailing lyric sheets to these folks, somebody came up with the idea of also sending a newsletter that would inform the recipient what we are up to, both in the band and with Grand Royal. The idea felt incredibly practical and incredibly boring, but instead of just bagging the idea and moving on, we talked ourselves into something way bigger and more ambitious. Let's make a magazine that covers all the kinds of stuff that we're into. The truth was, we weren't just interested in producing some Xerox fanzine. We wanted our shit to look legit, like a real magazine, like a cross between Spy and The Face and Thrasher, with the humor of Monty Python and Mad Magazine. So, we decided to do it. Once again, we had absolutely no idea what the hell we were getting ourselves into. I mean, the premise of covering topics we are interested in seems straightforward enough, but the logistics of producing an actual magazine were way beyond any of us. The first order of business was finding an editor. I can't remember exactly how we ended up hiring Bob Mack. What I do remember is that he'd written a Spin magazine article about us that in his mind was flattering. In our minds, it was not. But that's kind of how Bob's mind works. He's also inspired and idealistic, so we hired him and gave him an office. Reed, desk in another broom closet at GSUN. Soon we discovered a problem. For Bob, deadlines were like a totally alien concept. Moving target would be generous. Pretty quickly, we found ourselves in the unlikely position of having to tell someone else they had to quit messing around and actually finish something. I wish I could say it worked. Often our days went something like this. We'd walk into the studio at our regular-ish, afternoon-ish time and decide to check in with Bob to see what had been happening all day on the magazine front. We'd enter Bob's office to find him in a hacking cough fit from doing one or several overly large bong hits. Every inch of his desk was completely littered with random papers, so there was no visible writing surface. We'd ask him for updates, he'd give us vague, evasive answers, and eventually, we'd have to take him to task. Somehow, we put out a first issue. The cover story was about Bruce Lee, and our man Bob really went deep. Beyond the piece about Bruce himself, we thought it would be cool to interview Kareem Abdul-Jabbar about the 4 years he spent learning martial arts from Lee, and somehow, miraculously, Bob made it happen. All of a sudden, there I was, interviewing one of my all-time heroes. Dreams becoming a reality. Crazy. Now we are all hooked. We wanted the next issues to tell even more elaborate stories. Bob was determined to track down the reclusive Lee Scratch Perry, and he eventually did, finding him in a rural alpine region of Switzerland. He became our cover story for issue number 2, which came out a year late. In future issues, we researched Moog synthesizers, made free flexi discs and posters as inserts, staged a verbal confrontation between Bob Mack and Ted Nugent, and even at one point built a demolition derby car that we entered and drove in an actual demolition derby. Another great thing about all this was that we were able to involve a ton of talented and creative co-conspirators. Spike Jones shot photos. Andy Jenkins, art director for Dirt Magazine, designed GR before handing over the reins to artist Jeff McFetridge. On the label side, a kid named Kenny the Tick Salcido, who started as an intern, would show up before anyone in the morning with a big gulp-sized 7-Eleven coffee to keep amped while he called radio stations all over the country to beg for airtime. Miwa Okamura, now a successful music executive, dealt with the record stores. We also released a few of our own side projects. A hardcore EP, Aglio e Olio, and Adam Horovitz's BS2000 and DFL, Dead Fucking Last. Looking back, most people who start labels or magazines usually have a manifesto, a specialized focus, or, you know, just a basic business plan. We had none of those things. All we had was the energy to dive in and keep things going until exhaustion or combustion overtook us.
Issue 1, 1993. The premier issue of Grand Royal Magazine was a 76-page martial arts-themed publication showcasing a Bruce Lee cover illustration. Featuring interviews with notables such as Russell Simmons, Lawrence Hubbard, The Far Side, George Clinton, Luscious Jackson, and Money Mark, as well as information on supporting Tibetan human rights, compassion in action. Ricky Powell's top 10 snaps, top beats, and top misleading album covers. Other highlights include favorite feuds, Mario C's clean recording tips. Additional features encompass Luscious Jackson discussing life in San Francisco, artwork by colorblind P-Funk legend George Clinton, a guide to living the Buttafuoco lifestyle, Marissa Fox's coverage of the 7th annual KISS convention. Furthermore, keyboard maestro Money Mark reminisced about his days as a ball boy for the Los Angeles Lakers. Issue number 2 of Grand Royal, titled Long Awaited, Much Anticipated, Grossly Outdated, boasted 140 pages of rich content and included a Bismarcky 7-inch flexi, with one side featuring a voicemail message of Bismarcky asking for his tapes.
With my tape set. I want my tapes. Bring me my tapes so my Benny and the Jets, please.
And the other, a cover of Elton John's Benny and the Jets in the most hilarious way possible. Iconics Weedy style cover display reggae icon Lee Scratch Perry with a giant spliff. Feminist icon Kathleen Hanna revealed to Mike D the conditions necessary for her to contribute to the magazine. Allison Anders, a renowned director, discussed living in Echo Park. Ricky Powell shared snapshots in his experience as a substitute teacher. Skateboarding legend Glenny Freeman recounted his top 10 old school skate stories, while Sonic Youth's Thurston Moore delved into the free jazz underground scene and offered recommendations for beginners. The issue contained a diverse range of content, including the Yowls family famous frittatas recipe and cooking advice for hip-hop artists on tour. The infamous Mulling Over the Mullet article explored the history, social impact, and evolution of the hairstyle, complete with Mike D's day-long experience wearing a mullet wig. The magazine also delved into conspiracy theories such as Timothy Leary's potential ties to the CIA. DJ Hurricane shared his thoughts on the film Dolomite, and Luscious Jackson's Jill talked with Viv Albertine of The Slits. Tamara Davis discussed film directing, while Mudhoney recounted their visit to the White House alongside Pearl Jam. The third issue of Grand Royal, titled Often Wrong, Never in Doubt, comprised of 140 pages, included a Grand Royal vintage synth iron-on transfer for your t-shirt. The cover, featuring an array of vintage synths, set the tone for the magazine's eclectic contents. Within its pages, readers were treated to an engaging tour of the best pools to skate in Los Angeles, guided by the talented Spike Jones. A captivating history of renowned hip-hop culture show, Graffiti Rock, was presented by host Michael Holman, who shared insights and anecdotes about the groundbreaking series. The magazine also offered a glimpse into the colorful and daring paintings of legendary stuntman Evel Knievel, revealing another side of the Daredevil's talents. Bob Nastanovich from the band Pavement shared his experiences publishing the Lucky Lavender, a niche gambling magazine for racehorse enthusiasts in Louisville, Kentucky. Mike Watt discovered life on the road with a cute van, while photographer Ricky Powell provided an entertaining account of his time spent with the iconic Harlem Globetrotters. Additionally, the issue featured a conversation with the creative and quirky Weird Al Yankovic, exploring his journey into the world of music parody. The Sounds of Science, a comprehensive segment, gave readers an extensive overview of vintage synths. The feature included an interview with the pioneering synth composer Wendy Carlos, Mike D's top 10 Moog synth record, a visit to the remarkable Oddities recording studio, a peek inside the fascinating New England Synth Museum, a journey through the history of the Thurman, and Stereo Lab's Tib Gain discussing the impact and legacy of Moog synthesizers. Readers were introduced to Jessica White, the Dancing Outlaw, an American folk dancer and entertainer from rural Appalachia, known for his unique and captivating blend of tap and clog dancing that carried on his father's legacy, which was featured in the same documentary of the same name. Joey Garfield's article, Say It, Don't Spray It, explored the captivating world of beatboxing with legendary Bismarcky, diving into the technique, skill, and appeal of this distinct musical art form. Lastly, the issue wrapped with an intriguing look into the history of Holloway House, a publishing powerhouse responsible for pulp fiction and exploitation novels that have captivated readers for decades. Issue 4 of Grand Royal, released in 1997, titled Nature, Science, Space, the Funk, Leisure, Spectacular, boasted 114 pages of eclectic content. The cover, adorned with a vibrant and abstract illustration with a pinball theme, hinted at a diverse and global subjects discussed within. The magazine came with Turntable, a visual history, a pullout poster that quickly became a favorite in college dorms. Among the issue's unique articles was I Am Not Beck, which brought attention to the annex of celebrity imposter Pete Rally. And What's My Name, Yo, Kid Rock? An extensive profile of rapper Kid Rock traced his journey from hopeful major label artist in the early 1990s to a local independent music mogul in Detroit. The article delved into Kid Rock's ever-changing image as he adapted to the current trends. Issue 4 featured an engaging interview with pinball wizard Lyman Sheets, who shared passion for and expertise in the classic arcade game. The magazine also provided a thorough guide to enjoying ramen, explored the exciting world of bicycles, and took a deep dive into the realm of Mexican wrestling. The magazine offered readers an exhaustive analysis of the history of turntables and taught them how to use one correctly. The Invisible Scratch Pickles article showcased the intricate art of turntable scratching aerobatics. The expanded Wu-Tang tribute section included behind-the-scenes access to Virgin Gambino on the set of their latest video, RZA conversing with a Shaolin master at the Wu Manor, a Wu-wear fashion spread throwdown, and a Wu activity page to challenge fans' knowledge. Finally, readers were captivated by the poignant story of Mike Watt's knees, narrated by the legendary musician himself, sharing his personal experiences and struggles. Issue 5 of Grand Royal magazine, titled Strictly Off the Hook, and released in 1997, boasted 116 pages packed with content that celebrated bass and technology. The cover showcasing a woman in Daisy Duke shorts standing atop a subwoofer perfectly encapsulated the theme of the issue. Included with the magazine were custom Grand Royal stickers and a cardboard cutout of the Grand Royal bass Jeep for readers to assemble. Supergrass, a well-known band, discussed their experiences visiting Kenny Rogers Roasters. The magazine also included an in-depth exploration of the history of vintage cameras. Ricky Powell's Music to Get Busy To featured insights from Ben Lee, Matt Penfield, Prince Paul, and Money Mark. A variety of bass-related articles filled the pages, such as Bass Tech 101, where the Dust Brothers learned from bass producer Tony Mercedes, and Bo and Luke, the Dukes of Bass, where Luke Skywalker and Pandas Bo Hansen vied for the title of bass royalty. DJ Shadow discussed the influence of Miami bass on the West Coast music scene, and Professor Booty investigated the history and mystique surrounding Miami bass. And a page dedicated to the Miami bass appreciation were also featured. Ultimately, Issue 5 provided readers with an immersive experience thoroughly exploring the world of bass and its many dimensions in music. Grand Royal's final issue celebrated the new millennium with a 116-page retrospective on pop culture, or music, and art. The issue included articles on the future of these fields and looked back at the magazine's impact and legacy. The cover design featured a collage of images from previous issues showcasing the magazine's unique visual style. A limited edition Grand Royal t-shirt offer was included as an extra. Some of the notable articles in the issue included a tribute to Evel Knievel, the future of auto locomotion, a Grand Royal timeline of demolition derby history, and a breakdown of basketball biographies. The issue also included the Grand Royal demolition calendar for 1998. Grand Royal Records and Grand Royal Magazine had a significant impact on the music industry and pop culture, despite their relatively short time spans.
It was a blast at first, making cool shit with a bunch of creative people, running around in our studio and out at shows, going from a single employee who answered fan mail to a full-blown operation that released records and a magazine was all-consuming for everyone who worked with us. We definitely never made money and probably lost a good amount, but that was never the point. Eventually, though, we realized it was spreading us too thin. Fundamentally, all we cared about was being in a band. To become publishers and label executives was never part of the plan. The magazine eventually petered out after 6 issues. With the label, there got to be too many chefs in the kitchen, with too much money being spent to have any real fun. We had drifted far off course from the fun and creative reasons we'd started it. Grand Royal had become like any other business. We had to sell records and magazines to survive. We became disenchanted and finally closed it all down in 2000. So we could refocus on the only thing that really mattered, making music.
The success of Grand Royal Records and the cult status of Grand Royal Magazine stand as a testament to the Beastie Boys' passion for art and their commitment to fostering a sense of community among like-minded creators. By providing a platform for emerging artists and championing groundbreaking music, the Beastie Boys have left an insane mark on the entertainment world, inspiring countless others to follow their footsteps and challenge the status quo. Unfortunately, Adam MCA Yock was diagnosed with cancer in 2009, and he passed away on May 4, 2012, at the age of 47. His death marked the end of the Beastie Boys, as the surviving members Mike D and Ad Rock decided not to make music under the Beastie Boys name again. In the years that followed, several events have honored Yock and the Beastie Boys' legacy. In 2013, Palmetto Playground in Brooklyn Heights was renamed Adam Yock Park. Ricky Powell passed away on February 1st, 2021, leaving behind a rich legacy of iconic images and memories that continue to inspire fans of the Beastie Boys, hip-hop, and New York City culture. Ian Rogers, a former roadie for the Beastie Boys, continued to excel in his career, becoming the first chief digital officer of luxury goods conglomerate LVMH in 2015. Although the Beastie Boys initially planned to release a book compiling the best content from Grand Royal Magazine's 6 issues along with the new unreleased material, it was never published. However, some excerpts found their way into the Beastie Boys books, which Mike D and Ad Rock released in 2018. The memoir recounts events through the group's history, including their time with Grand Royal Records and the magazine. In 2020, the memoir was adapted into a documentary, Beastie Boys Story, directed by Spike Jones and released on Apple TV+. Accompanying these releases was a compilation album, Beastie Boys Music, in October 2020. Despite setbacks like the failure to publish the planned coffee table book titled Grand Royal, which would have compiled articles from the magazine, the influence of Grand Royal continues to be felt, ensuring the spirit of the Beastie Boys' groundbreaking contributions to music and culture lives on.